The song goes, our God is greater, he is stronger, and he's higher than any other. Come on, can we sing this together this morning? Hey.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, there's none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, there's none like you. And our God is greater, our God is stronger, God you are high. And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us?
The power of an almighty God. Hallelujah.
Hey, God, we love you. Yeah. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
Jesus, hallelujah.
Your name is above all names. You're worthy of all our praise. Mighty are the works of your hands. And mighty are the words of your hands. Your name is above all names. You're worthy of all our praise. Mighty are the works of your hands. Mighty are the works of your hands. Oh, and mighty are the works of your hands.
Yes.
Mighty are the works of your hands. Oh,
you are worthy. worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. For you, oh, we live.
Rebuild family and friends, so glad to be back together with you again with our online celebration service. So thank you for being here with us. And Rebuild family, you already know what to do. This is our love moment. This is the part of all of our celebration services where we take a moment to love one another by spreading love or sending love by way of our online chat and comment section. So if you would begin to fill up the chat with hearts, comment section with hearts, and then specifically, if there is somebody on your heart and mind that you want us to pray with you on, believing that God will send his love to them, whatever they may be going through in their life right now, if you will put three hearts in the front and back of their name, and your faith-filled brothers and sisters will see those names and they will begin to pray and ask God to move in their lives as only he can do, and that he will send his love to them. Because, hey, we believe here at Rebuild that this is a place where our lives and the love of God meeting. So this is our love moment. Thank you for spreading love as far and wide as you possibly can in this moment. And as you're doing so, I want to welcome our guest here that's with us. Maybe you are with us here for the first time, and I want to thank you for being here. If you have been with us before and you're back again, I want to say thank you for doing that. For our first time guest, here's what I would like for you to do. As a token of our appreciation for you being here, would you simply text the word guest to 833-473-7373. Text that word guest there. There's a couple things that we want to do. Number one, we want to send you a gift via email for us saying thank you for you being here. The second thing we want to do is just have your name so we can continue to pray for you. It's a way that we can continue on serving those that have a touch point with us here at Rebuild. And so thank you so very much for indulging us in that way. So again, if you would text the word guest to 833-473-7373. Rebuild family and friends, this is also time, another way that we respond to the good news of Jesus Christ. We believe here at Rebuild Fellowship, our mission is three key statements or three areas. We want to receive the good news of Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ did everything necessary for our salvation, and he has offered it to us as a free gift. He has done the necessary, needed work for our salvation. The second thing that we do, we respond to it, and we respond to that by loving the Lord God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, as he has commanded us to do. And then being disciples who go and make disciples, which leads us to our last point or mission value statement, which is we reproduce the good news in the life of somebody else. And we are disciples on mission to go and make disciples. And so with that being said, here's your way to partner in with us in advancing the kingdom of Jesus Christ here in the earth. You can text the word give to 833-473-7373. Give to 833-473-7373. And so what you enable us to do here as a church body is a whole host of areas. We're able to continue on advancing our discipleship ministries, our women's ministry, our men's ministry, our children's ministry, our music ministry, and all of the other ministries that are growing and will soon be established here at Rebuild Fellowship. That's one thing you're able to do. The second thing you're able to do is help us to serve the least of these in our community. So we're able to give and serve in ways that help to instill hope, to give life to those who may be in a hard season right now. It's also able to take care of our very own by a number of ways where we are benevolent and being sacrificial in our giving in that way to take care of our own family members who may be in need. And the list goes on and on and on of ways that your generosity is impacting the lives of so many here within the walls of Rebuild Fellowship and outside the walls of Rebuild Fellowship. So Rebuild family and friends, I want to thank you for your generosity. I want to thank you for continuing to aid us and being a church on mission for the Lord Jesus Christ. Your generosity has allowed us to start accumulating which your generosity has gone to almost, I think maybe we're now 150, maybe pushing 200 range for backpacks. And so thank you for giving in that way. And we'll continue on with our times of drop off on next week or next Tuesday, next Wednesday, next Thursday from 3 to 6 again. And then Eastway, the school that we're seeking to bless They're having an event at their church, at their school, on next Saturday, August the 14th. And so anybody that's willing to come be a part of that, if you would just simply email info@rebuildchurch.com to let us know you're interested in serving. And we will send you all the information, what it entails, the time period, the location, all of those details. We will email back to you if you're interested in coming being a part. We're going to take all of this good stuff that you all have been generous with providing for these children to help them get as successful of a start to their school year as possible, to give them some hope, to give them some encouragement, and to let them know there's a group of people here in Durham that's cheering them on. And so would you continue on giving this week? Would you continue on giving in this way? There's so many children that could benefit from this blessing here, and we want to make sure that we are able to maximize our generosity in that way. So thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Also, I want to let you know that we have come to the end of our summer slowdown. Come to the end of some slowdown. So what does that mean? That means we're going back to full programming, which means this coming Monday, tomorrow. Tomorrow we'll be back with our men's discipleship, which starts at 7:30. And then our women's discipleship, which starts on Wednesday back at 8 p.m. And so we want to see your face in a place. For more information about that, just simply go to our website, rebuildchurch.com, to get all of that information that you have there. And as I'm talking about children, I'm talking about discipleship and how all these things come together through your generosity and through your time and your talents and your treasures. I want to invite you in to serving with our Little Builders as we prepare to relaunch in September. The third Sunday in September is when we will meet in person, and that's when we will relaunch our Little Builders ministry. And so with that being said, you should have received, by way of your update, two surveys. We need that from the parents, and we also need that from those who served or have served or are interested in serving with our Little Builders ministry. So would you go back in your emails, and would you look for that? Would you go back in your text messages and look for that? Because there are the links to those surveys that we need you to fill out. This is something really that we, if I can mandate it, I mandate it. I'm asking you, with all the love, fervor, and passion that I have in this moment, would you please, family, would you please look at your updates? Would you click on the links, and would you fill out those surveys? If you are a parent and or a team member of our Little Builders ministry, we need this information. There's some instructions within those updates that will help guide you with filling out those surveys. And of course, many hands make light work, and so we would love to have more serving team members be a part of our Little Builders ministry and the host of other ministries that we have here, from our creative team, which is our videos and social media and audio team, from our music ministry, from our love team, our guest services, our hospitality, our Logos team, which is the ones who go out, the mission arm of our church. So we want you to be a part in as whatever ways the Lord is leading you. But we need more serving team members in all areas. But I wanted to specifically highlight our Little Builders in this moment. And so, family, with that being said, without further ado, we are continuing on in our Summer in the Psalm series. And I told you I have some gifts for you along the way. I have some surprises for you along the way. And I want to let you know that, again, that there's been a group of your brothers and sisters who I believe have a teaching and preaching gift here at our church. And I started to walk with them and equip them and encourage them in their gift. And so with that being said, we have another one of your family members here at Rebuild who's going to bring the word for us today. She is beloved by so many. Probably many of you have experienced her big, beautiful smile, her nurturing, comforting spirit, or maybe you have received a good old meal from her. She's none other than the owner and operator of Virginia and Co. Catering Company. She has been a blessing to me. She's been my sister now in Christ for, man, close to 20 years now. And I'm blessed to have her as a part of one of our faith warriors here at Rebuild. And so I bring to you, my brothers and sisters, none other than the beloved Natalege, better known as Joy Joy Bryant, to bring God's word today. So would you begin praying for her in this moment with me? Father, we thank you, first of all, that you saved Joy. You saved her, and you set her free, and you're still setting her free. Father, I thank you for your grace in her life that is truly sufficient for her in any area of weakness in her life. I thank you, Lord God, that you have prepared her and anointed her for such a time as this. God, now may the words of her mouth and the meditations of her heart be acceptable in your sight, because you are, Lord, her strength and her redeemer. I pray that we as her family will cheer her on in this moment, knowing that apart from you, she can do nothing. We know that. We're thankful for that. But God, just for her to know, Lord God, that she's surrounded by a cloud of earthly witnesses who love her, who appreciate her, and we're believing God's very best for her, her son Miles, and our beloved honorary mother of this church, Helen Bryant, to the Bryant family at large. Lord God, we thank you for this gift that we have in Joy Bryant. Lord, we bless you, we honor you, and we pray, Lord God, that you would give us ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord wants to say to his people in this moment. God, prepare our hearts and minds to receive from the throne of grace the word of truth that's coming from your servant, Joy Bryant. It's in Jesus' name I pray and give thanks. Amen. Receive the ministry gift. Joy Bryant, my brothers and sisters. God bless you.
Good morning, Rebuild family. I am so excited to be here with you this morning. I am Natalie Bryant, also known as Joy or Joy Joy, to my Rebuild family and beyond. I am really, really humbled and honored to be in front of you, sharing with you a word that ministered to me so greatly many months ago when God first gave it to me. I want to say thank you to Chuck Reed, the pastor of Rebuild Fellowship. He is my pastor, but he's also my brother and my friend. And so I am very, very grateful for him and grateful for how he has been a shepherd in my own life. We continue to be in the Summer of Psalms series, and today we are continuing in that series, continuing in Psalms. In fact, and we're going to be in Psalms 119. So as Pastor Chuck always tells us, if you're a cool kid, turn your e-Bibles on, and we're going to go to Psalm 119, 67, and 71. If you paper Bible saved, then you're going to pull out your tree Bible, and we're going to go to Psalm 119. We're coming from 67 and 71, and I will be reading from the New International Version. So Psalms 119, 67 reads, "Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word." 71 reads, "It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees." And as a title for my message today, it is "Afflicted for My Good." Afflicted for my good. So we are going to go to the throne of grace in prayer this morning. Father God, in the precious name of Jesus, God, you are the true source of light and wisdom, the origin of all that is. God, I thank you for calling me to faith, for planting your word in my heart, and for delivering me from my sin. God, I thank you for calling me to your service, for giving me the ability to teach your word and share this good news with others this morning. God, I'm overwhelmed at the thought of teaching on the gospel. I feel so inadequate to deliver something so valuable about news that is so priceless. And I'm unworthy to be given the privilege of thinking deeply about news that's too marvelous for even an angel to comprehend. God, be ever gracious to me. Let a ray of your light penetrate the darkness of my understanding. Give me the confidence and the power of your gospel. Grant me clarity in understanding and proclaiming the truths of your word. Edify your church through this work. Father Almighty, empower your people to tell the gospel story, to recount your wondrous deeds, which shine light on your glorious and holy character. Lord Jesus, empower your people to announce the good news that you have brought to earth the life of heaven, that you have sacrificed yourself for sinners, that you have been raised from the dead and exalted as Lord over all creation. Holy Spirit, empower us to live in the light of the gospel, declaring its truth with our words and embodying this truth through our actions. Give us love for you and love for one another. In these things we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, guys, I'm so excited, as I said before. I know I have told y'all that at least three times before that I'm really excited, but I really am to share this word with you this morning that really ministered to me and continues to minister to me. And we're just going to jump right in. So one thing that I really believe and I have a theory on is that no matter your race, your gender, your socioeconomic background, we have experienced some of the same things, all of the same things, as a matter of fact. And one of those things is when we get in trouble with our mamas, and that includes my own mama, Mama Helen, we're going to hear one of these phrases. So Rebuild Family, this morning, I want you to finish these phrases with me that I heard from my mama, but I know you heard from your mama too. So I brought you into this world, I can take you out. A hard head makes a soft behind, and I heard that a lot. And my personal favorite that I even tell my own baby, you gonna learn today. This last mama colloquialism perfectly sums up Psalms 119, 67, and 71. Although the writer of Psalm 119 is unknown, the entire psalm is, as the great Tony Evans describes, an appreciation for, celebration of, and dependency on the Word of God to enable us to properly negotiate the twists and turns of life. And Lord knows life is full of twists and turns. The psalmist describes his dependency on the Word of God as being consumed with longing for the Word. He declares his delight in, how he rejoices in, how he meditates on, how he finds comfort in, how he reaches out for, how he puts his hope and trust in, and ultimately how he hastens to the Word of God. In our highlighted text, the psalmist tells us in verse 67 that before he was afflicted, he went astray. The Hebrew word for astray is nagag, and it means to wander. In fact, we know that we are prone to wander. The holy God that we serve understands this condition of man and our tendency to wander from his grace, his provision, his protection, by being outside of his word. He sent the word made flesh so that we might be reconciled to him and the abundant life that he has for us. The prophet Isaiah lived during a time when the children of Israel, God's chosen people, had turned their back on God. And Isaiah declares in Isaiah 53 and 6, we all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. As I began to study and wrestle with the text, these are the questions that God presented to me to share and present holy insight on specifically self-inflicted affliction, things that we willfully choose to run towards instead of running towards God. So the first question that God gave me to present to you this morning is, why do we go astray? The second question is, how can affliction possibly be good? And then the third question that God gave me was, what does God desire from me during my affliction? So the first question is, why do we go astray? Although the psalmist does not deal with this, the Holy Spirit impressed upon me the need to examine, why do we go astray? We must get to the root cause of a thing because we can't treat what we misdiagnose. I believe that there are three major causes of how we find ourselves doing our own thing. One, we have not submitted to the lordship of God in every area of our life. Specifically, we trust God in some areas, but then in other areas, we still want to be in control. Hudson Taylor, a British missionary, said it best, Christ is either Lord of all or he is not Lord at all. Number two, we have exalted ourselves in our heart over God, This often happens in times of great prosperity in our lives. And instead of God being in his proper place as king of my heart, I am now in charge. I am ruler. And then third, we need look no further than our sinful nature. It is literally part of our manufactured settings that we inherited from Adam. Paul succinctly describes our sinful nature in Romans 7:21. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. We are disobedient by nature. As we continue to dig, we see the author explain to us the consequence of his going astray with his was his affliction. I love this author's self-awareness about his affliction because of his own disobedience. It's a place that's not unfamiliar to anyone, especially myself. But even in our own self-inflicted affliction, we see the goodness of our Father because he uses it as an opportunity to teach us. I love this quote by J.C. Ryle, and he understood affliction probably better than anyone. He lost his first two wives to death prematurely. And he says that affliction God uses to teach us many precious lessons, which without it, we should never learn. By affliction, he shows us our emptiness and weakness, draws us to the throne of grace, purifies our affections, weans us from this world, and makes us long for heaven. We need look no further for God's goodness in the middle of self-inflicted affliction than the prophet Jonah, who we're reading about this week in our Bible reading plan. So Jonah has instruction from God, and God is telling him that he wants him to go to Nineveh to prophesy to his people. And because of Jonah's own personal reasons, he chooses to flee from the presence of God and to not follow the instruction that God has given him. And so through a series of events, Jonah ends up in the belly of a fish. And likewise, family, we often end up in situations of our own making when all we had to do was obey. God is saying that some lessons you don't have to learn the hard way. You can just obey him. Jonah cries out to God, and God hears him, he saves him, and then he gives him the instruction again, and this time Jonah obeys. The story of Jonah is rich in lessons, but one of the Holy Spirit impressed upon me is that no matter what, God is going to get the glory. So the next question that God really had me wrestle with is, how can affliction possibly be good? In verse 71, the author goes on to tell us that it was good for him to be afflicted because now he has learned God's statutes. Francis Atterbury gives us a great insight on why affliction is good. He says that affliction is a school of virtue. It corrects levity and interrupts the confidence of sinning. So I'm going to say that again. Affliction is a school of virtue. It corrects levity and interrupts the confidence of sinning. And Lord knows I was a confident sinner. In the text, the word affliction means to put down or become low. It also means to humble oneself or bow down. Our affliction in this text is meant to humble us and put God back in his proper place in our life. We must be brought low to understand his goodness during all times. There are just certain lessons that I may never learn without great suffering. There are innumerable answers, and there are innumerable experiences of this great mercy that God is showing us. But here are five from the Word of God. So, one, affliction takes away the fraudulent facade we often have of God and ensures that we engage with a holy God with reverence. James 4:8 tells us, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Number two, affliction knocks world props out from under us and forces us to be totally dependent on God, which brings us more in tune with the aim of the Word of God. For the aim of the Word of God is that we hope and trust in God. Romans 15 and 4 states, whatever was written in former days was written for instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. John 20 and 31 states, these things are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Number three, affliction makes us search the scriptures with greater desperation for help. Jeremiah 29 and 13 tells us, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. Number four, affliction brings us into the partnership of Christ's sufferings so that we fellowship more closely with him and see the world more readily through his eyes. Paul tells us his great heart longing in Philippians 3 and 10 when he says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share sufferings becoming like him in his death. And then finally, number five, affliction subdues deceitful and distracting fleshly desires, and so brings us back into the spiritual framework of God and makes us receptive to the spiritual word of God. 1 Peter 4 and 1 states, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. God is telling us in this text, suffering has a great sin-killing effect. And the more pure we are, the more clearly we see God. Matthew 5 and 8 tells us, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. So what does God desire from me during my affliction? What do I do when I find myself in a bed of my own making? If, like Jonah, I'm in the belly of a fish because I decided to willfully walk away from God. When I knew the right thing to do, but I chose another way. What is God calling me to do in this moment? It's simple. Affliction is not canceling God's call for obedience. Job, who, unlike the psalmist, was afflicted not because he went astray, but because he was beset by Satan with God's permission with horrendous disasters that take away all that he holds dear, including his children, his health, and his property. He struggles to understand his situation and searches for answers to his affliction. Job's posture during great suffering is what I believe to be one of our action steps here today. Job laments to his friends in Job 13 and 15, though he slay me, I will hope in him. Job knew that even in his place of grief, even in his loss, his deep anger, his hope was in God. And this is the key. Whether I'm in the middle of calamity because of my own decision to go astray, or whether it is through no fault of my own, my hope must be in God. And my hope can only be firmly planted in God if I'm firmly rooted in his word. James 5 and 11 states it beautifully. You know we call those blessed who were steadfast and endured. You have heard of the patient endurance of Job, and you have seen the Lord's outcome. The Lord is full of compassion and he's merciful. God is telling us that even in our affliction, that he still calls us blessed and that we must A, have patient endurance and B, be steadfast. God in his infinite wisdom uses our affliction to point us back to him and his holy word and set us back on a right path. He used my own mess to remind me that nothing matters except him. He used my mess to pull me closer to him because he wants nothing more than to be in relationship with his daughter. And like a good father, he used my mess to teach me his precepts and have a deeper understanding of his word. He used my mess to make his word come alive in my own life. Without my own self-inflicted affliction, I never would have understood the words of Paul when he tells us in Romans, and we know that God works all things together for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. Even the messes I make, even my disobedience, even when I fall, even when I go astray, even in my self-inflicted affliction, God is working all things together for my good. So family, here's my challenge for you this morning. For the believer, maybe you have gone astray. Maybe you have made a willful decision to turn away from God. Or maybe you don't even know how you got to this place. You just know that you are so far away from God's presence. It's really, really simple. You just got to repent. The time is now. And for the unbeliever, you may feel lost in this world, but in this moment, I believe that God is calling you. He wants to be closer to you. His desire is that none should perish and that none have to go astray. I want to invite you into a posture of holy surrender right now. He loves you and he wants to hear from you. Romans chapter 10 says, if you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. And if you believe those words from Romans, confess that this morning and you are saved. You can type in the comment section, Lord, I believe, or Lord, I confess, or Lord, I surrender. And we want to pray for you this morning. Father God, in the precious name of Jesus, God, we thank you for your holy word this morning. We thank you for loving us in the midst of our willful disobedience. God, we can't begin to comprehend your great and unfailing love towards your people. We are humbled by this. We ask for forgiveness for any times we willfully walked away from you, from your protection and safety. Father, thank you that even in the wilderness, you have continued to be you, unchanging, still the same, still mighty, still marvelous, still able to do all things in and through us. God, thank you that any infliction that we encountered in our disobedience pointed us back to you. God, this morning we also lift up the unbeliever. God, I remember my own beautiful love story with you. I remember the way you pursued me, even when I was sinking very deeply in sin. You loved me when I felt the most unlovable. Father, just as you called me to you, I know that you're calling others. You desire for none to perish. Father, pierce the hearts of my brothers and sisters. Open their hearts and minds to you, Father. Let your Holy Spirit minister to them. Lead them to repent their sins and surrender their lives to you, that they may see your kingdom. Give them the strength and wisdom to always call on you when they get tempted to go back to sin. Give them the surety that we all sin, and as a faithful Father, you forgive our sins, never to remember them again. Father, again, we love you so, and we pray these things in your Son, Jesus Christ's beautiful, matchless, and holy name. Amen. Amen, family. Thank you so much for having me this morning. I am so excited to hear about how this word ministered to you the way it ministered to me.
Rebuild family and friends, I don't know about you, but that is definitely a convicting message. I had flashbacks of my life where I have seen where I have gone astray in former days and in recent days. And I thank the Holy Spirit for always calling back my wandering mind and loving me the way that he loves me. That is true what the author of Lamentations says, and many of you know it. Rebuild is one of my favorite scriptures that I call to my mind, and therefore I have hope that the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies are new every morning. Great is the Lord's faithfulness. So I thank him even for providing that word through his daughter Joy in this moment to help us to not go astray. If we have gone astray, to come back home into his loving arms. And so I want to ask you, if you have made a decision, would you take this next step for me, please? That same number that you see pinned on the bottom of your screen, 833-473-7373. If you text the word decision, if you accepted the gift of salvation, the free gift of salvation that Jesus provided for us when he came and wrapped himself in this sinful flesh and he lived a perfect and obedient life. And he went to that cross on our behalf and he shed his precious blood and he willingly laid down his life for us. And then he was resurrected by God the Father. And in that beautiful week, he would, that beautiful, glorious week, he would defeat sin on Friday, the enemy on Saturday, and death on Sunday for each and every one of us. And he would offer us to us that gift of salvation, that he has paid our sin debt in full. We don't have to earn or work for this salvation. He gives it to us freely. So with that being said, if you have received that, if you desire to experience a love that this world can't even comprehend, but he gives us little nuggets. He gives us little ways to experience it and know that there is no other love that's greater than the love of our Heavenly Father by sending his only begotten Son to do for us what we were unable to do for ourselves. If you have desired and purpose in your heart to receive that free gift today, would you text the word decision? And when you text that word decision, it will send you a link to let us know that you made that decision today, that you got saved. And what we want to do is we want to come alongside you. We want to continue to pray, and we want to invite you in to become a family member of Rebuild Fellowship. And maybe you may say, hey, I don't know if that's okay. Okay, well, we want to walk you through a process still of the early stages, the infant stages of what's known as discipleship, which is us taking the steps to become more and more like Christ our Lord, to become more Christ-like here in the earth. And so maybe Rebuild may not be your church, but we want to help guide you and lead you and give you some sound wisdom and counsel as to what to look for in a church. And so allow us to serve you in that way. Maybe, hey, you are a believer and you went astray. You've been trying to do life in your own strength. You haven't connected to covenant community here through this church in quite some time. Maybe you haven't been praying as you know you could be. You haven't been reading or studying in your word as you know you could be. You have gone astray and you begin to lean into your own understanding. You haven't acknowledged Jesus in all your ways so that he can direct your path. Maybe that's you. The Lord is saying, here, son, daughter, my arms are wide open. I still love you. And he says, even in his word, that he's married to the backslider. Would you come back home? If that's you, you can text that same word, and there's in that also, it will let us know that, hey, I'm rededicating my life back to Christ. I'm coming back. I just wanna repent. I wanna turn, and I wanna say, Lord, I'm sorry for trusting in me and not in you. So if that's you, you can send us that same thing, because we want to come alongside you and pray with you. We want you to know that you're not alone in this. And we all, listen, hear me clearly. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We have all fallen short of his glory, but he's always there with his strong right arm to lift us up. And he loves us so much, he desires to give us his strength. That's what the Apostle Paul learned. He says, in my weakness, God's strength is made perfect. Would you receive his strength to come back home and to walk with him and to talk with him and to love him and to serve him and to keep your eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of your faith? He will give you the strength to be able to do that. So would you text that word decision there if you fall into that category as well? And some of you family, some of you, here's another next step that is directly tied into that. Maybe you have professed Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. You've received this free gift of salvation, but you haven't taken the next step of obedience and faith by going public with your decision, with honoring the Lord in that way, with glorifying him that way by way of baptism. And baptism is a symbolic demonstration of the salvific work of Jesus Christ. We identify with his death, burial, and resurrection, and we recognize that the old man to live is Christ and to die is gain, as the scripture says. And so we recognize that we have died to self and we have been raised to new life in Christ Jesus by the Spirit of the true and living God. And so this is a public demonstration to say, I serve Jesus. He is my Lord. He is my Savior. He is my rock. And he is my refuge. And as Romans 1:16 says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And I don't mind letting the world know that I belong to him. He is mine and I am his. And so with that being said, if you want to take that next step, text that word decision to that same number and we will get you connected to being baptized here at Rebuild Fellowship. My brothers and sisters, this is a time of prayer and a time to refocus and reorient our lives to the truth of God's holy word, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He knows what's best for us. He desires what's best for us. And it's important for us to lean into him. Again, as I've been saying from Proverbs 3, to acknowledge him in all our ways, so he can direct our paths. And family, I've learned it was good that I was afflicted. I didn't think it was at the time, but it was good that I was afflicted when I strayed. The word of God said, I went astray, then I was afflicted. The verse before, I went astray, then I was afflicted. But in that place, I learned God's word. And a lot of these verses that I've come to know and love that has kept me is because I went astray and had to endure affliction. So family, he's here. He loves us. He cares for us. He knows what's best, and he'll never leave or forsake us. And so with that being said, family, may the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in our believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we will abide in hope. Have a wonderful, wonderful, joy-filled Sunday. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to now go spread his love as far and wide as you are possibly able to do today and for the days to come. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all.